want to first of all thank Todd Wise and Kevin Tacher for putting this on. It's going to be very informative finding out what you need to do to help yourself out with when you come across listings with divorces.
So I've been the title company here for quite a long time, and what we're trying to do now is come up with relevant topics that can not only educate you, because what we've done in the past is give you a little bit more education, but we're trying to more, with all the new classes we're doing, empower you with tools that you can now go out, and now you can say, I'm an expert in a certain industry. So like we spoke about our last one, we were talking about marketing, we're gonna be doing a social media one, you know, because we want you to have the tools that you can really go out and make more money, right? That's the whole goal. Because the more money you make, hopefully the more closings you get, hopefully, obviously, the more closings we're going to get, because it's going to be a win-win for everyone, because we don't make money unless you do. So today we do have two fantastic attorneys in the room. So we do have, from Wise Lieberman, we have Wise and Lieberman. They're both here. One of the ground rules I just wanted to set is this is not going to be a venue for legal advice. They can't give legal advice, because it would be illegal for them to sit here and start doing that. We're not trying to form any type of attorney-client privilege with you guys. Okay, so we're going to cover some of the general things, and the reason we wanted to put this one on, how many of you have listed divorce properties before? Some of you. So it really is a strong market that you can go to, because what's happening when you find these clients that are going through a divorce? What are you typically seeing?
They have not agreed.
So anger, right?
Anger.
Maybe you have to become an anger management person. Deal with two sides, right? You're going to have to sit with the two sellers, with a husband and a wife, and one of the parties is going to say, this one's stealing from me, or this one's not being fair, or I don't want to be put out on the street, right? Some of the common things you're going to see.
I don't want to sell it. I don't want to sign.
Right. I don't want to sell it. And then the question is, well, who's going to afford to pay for it? Because typically in a divorce situation, both parties, either party cannot afford the house usually on their own. It's usually mortgaged, there's a big mortgage payment, and most of the time you're not seeing one party gets to keep it. Many years ago maybe, but you're not seeing that in today's market. People aren't earning enough income for your average person. We're not talking ultra wealthy, we're talking your average day-to-day worker cannot afford a house on their own. It's very, very difficult. So we wanted to put this on just to give you some of the common things that we're seeing. From a title perspective, because Todd will be able to talk more on the legal perspective of some of the things that he sees, but some of the things that we see that we need to be careful for are spouses that are trying to sell a house without the other spouse. Okay, we were just talking earlier as we got started, the home stealing scam of the guy that we caught a year ago in our office trying to sell a house he didn't own, and we see this. We see spouses, we had one in the office the other day, that the husband came in to sell the house, and it was the husband's house, but meanwhile the wife took out three mortgages that the husband didn't even know about. And it was all fraudulent. And he was put himself in a position to say, okay, do I walk away today paying these houses off with a $30,000 check, or do I turn around and try and sue to get maybe $100,000? And it just wasn't worth it for him at that point. He just wanted to be done with it. But we were able to sit with him and navigate through that. And let's look at the real situation and say, do you really have a valid claim? Because your signature's on this mortgage, whether you really signed it or not, you're gonna have to spend a lot of money in legal expenses to battle it out. You're gonna lose the buyer on your house, and who knows what's gonna happen with the market. So you have a decision to make. Take your $30,000 now, or fight it out, and maybe you'll get more in the end. And he called his wife, and the issue was his wife was a drug addict, and it was the money was to bail her boyfriend out of jail. I mean, these are the crazy things that we see, and this is just one example of something that we've seen recently where they're taking mortgages out. They take private mortgages. Lines of credits are another big one. You know, you'll see a spouse that drew against the line of credit on the house. So let's say you have a second mortgage, $100,000. All of a sudden, the husband or the wife go on a spending spree. Right, and they spend all this money, and then what happens when they come to the table? They didn't know, right? They come to the table, they had no clue that that mortgage existed, or they said, well, there was no balance on that. There is now. Why? Because one of the spouses went and took that money out and spent it wherever they spent it. Okay, so a lot of the things that we're seeing is gonna help you navigate to understand what's going on. Talking about lines of credit, a good example is, you know, when you're sitting with your clients to ask, What type of mortgages do you have on the house? Do you have a first mortgage? Do you have a second mortgage? Your job as a realtor is not anymore just list the house and hopefully a buyer comes in. It's to analyze the true situation to make sure in the end, you're not gonna be stopped from getting a commission. Because very easily a second mortgage, a third mortgage, or an argument between spouses can prevent you from getting that money. Hopefully they have a good law firm that's working with them and can help navigate it. But again, it's one of the largest problems we have. And the reality is for most people, the house is the largest asset, right? I know for me, my house is my largest asset that I've ever owned in my life. You know, you buy this house, you invest all your money in it. Even if you have a mortgage, typically there's still some equity in it. And it's one of your largest investments. And that's what causes these arguments. You know, we see this day to day when it comes to divorces. And the last part that I want to talk about when it comes to divorces, which why it's very important if you're taking a divorce listing, is to make sure you're working with a title company, whether it's us or you use somebody else, to make sure that they truly understand how to navigate what Todd will talk about with the marital settlement agreement. That's the agreement between the two parties that we need to make sure they know how to navigate, and they know how in the end they're going to be able to disperse the proceeds according to the agreement. Because we've picked up several closings from people that say the attorney or title company is not willing to disperse the proceeds as it says in the agreement. Because a lot of them are scared. A lot of them say, nope, we're going to give it to the divorce attorney and let the divorce attorney deal with it. Or they're going to say, put it in the courts and let the courts deal with it. Or worse, make it payable to the husband and the wife and let them deal with it. And we know what happens there. They're not going to deal with it, right? One person's going to deposit the check. Another person's going to take the money, and then it's going to turn into a big problem. So, you know, we see this every day. We're doing on average 90 to 100 closings a month, and I would say we probably have 3 to 5 divorce situations in any given time that we're having to navigate. Some are very simple, if they're amicable, and some are not. And when you're dealing with buyers, right, because that's typically on the seller side, you know, if you can start thinking forward to protect the interests of the client, again, we're not giving legal advice, but you want to make sure your clients are titling property properly. So if you have a buyer that comes to you and say, oh, my wife and I are buying a house, you should put them both on the contract, right? They should both be there. Because in the end, what happens is we're seeing people that are buying houses, they buy it maybe just in the husband's name or the wife's name, and now that spouse will turn around and try and sell that property because the other spouse's name doesn't appear anywhere on public record. Okay, so we have our attorney, one of our real estate attorneys that talks clients through this process to make sure that property is being titled properly with what they're looking to accomplish. There are times where only the husband may be on or only the wife, if maybe one's getting a loan and they don't want to appear on there for whatever reason. But typically, if someone is buying a house they're going to live in, they should, and they're married, they should have husband and wife, which is called tenancy by the entireties, both on title for many, many reasons. One for homestead purposes, one for tax purposes, judgment proofs them. So if there's a judgment in one name and they own it as a joint asset, the judgment goes away when they go to sell it. If just the husband owns it and the husband has, let's say, a judgment for a credit card and they go to sell, we now have to have the conversation with the husband and say, hey, because you didn't put your spouse on title when you purchased the house, this judgment now has to be paid. So it's very scary that, you know, a lot of the real estate agents that we're seeing, they either don't understand the ramifications for down the line, what can happen. Because from a title perspective, that's what we see. You know, we're insuring a property today for issues that may come up 6 months down the line, a year down the line, 5 years down the line, sometimes 10 years. I just had one where a client tried to take us to court saying she didn't sign the mortgage at closing. It was a refinance, her and her husband. She says, that wasn't my signature. I said, well, I have your ID. I can't tell you whether you were there 10 years ago. And she was just trying to get out of paying for the mortgage because her husband said, I'm getting divorced and I'm leaving. You take the house, I'm leaving, I'll sign it over to you. And she couldn't pay it anymore. So now she was trying to blame us to say she wasn't at closing. And these are things that happen in a divorce that we see on a regular basis. So to wrap it up on our side, that's why we wanted to put this class on, so we can hopefully better educate you, so now you can start targeting divorce listings and say, listen, I understand, because usually you're going to be dealing with one spouse. One spouse is going to call you, and then later you're going to have the conversation with both. And it's going to be a difficult conversation if you don't have the tools necessary in order to make yourself walk in as an expert. So if you can walk into a divorce listing, or you can work with divorce attorneys, you know, that we talked last month when we did the presentation on marketing and stuff, we talked about some of your contact spheres. So now you have the tools necessary to be able to go to a divorce attorney and say, I understand your pain. I am an expert at navigating through a divorce listing, right? I know what to look for. I know how to work with these clients. I know what to tell them. I know how to take the time in making sure that all sides are covered, how to investigate how many mortgages they have. Are they in agreement on price? Because what's going to happen, as I said, is in the end, you're going to find yourself put in a position where you're going to lose your commission. And what did you do for all this time? Hours and hours and hours of work that you're not going to get paid for. Because if they don't agree, then it has to go to court, and you may or may not get your money in the end if there's enough room, right? If there's enough equity, if you find out something later on. So hopefully, you know, Todd will give you a little bit of more on the divorce side. And if you have questions, we wanted to make this an open forum as well, so you can ask your questions. Ask your questions that you have, things that you're thinking, maybe issues that you've seen in a divorced listing. We just don't want to make it about you personally if you're having any issues, because he's not here again to give any legal advice. Sound good? All right. Take over.
Thank you very much, Kevin, for having me and my law firm here today. My name is Todd Wise. I'm the founding partner of Wise Lieberman, PLLC. My partner is in the room as well. It's Andrew Lieberman. We deal in the sphere of divorce and family law. Now, divorce is very common. Family law covers a lot of different ambits. It covers paternity. It covers child support. It covers dependency. But today I'm going to focus on what most people perceive as family law in terms of divorce. When someone walks into our office, I always ask them what Kevin just said, what's the largest asset of your marriage? And typically the largest asset of the marriage is the marital residence. No matter how it's titled, they bought this home, it was a very big life event, they put down a lot of money, a lot of blood, sweat, and tears went into the home, and now they're getting divorced. So what happens on that divorce petition? Well, we do what's called a partition count. Partition count is where we ask the court to break what Kevin described as what's called a tenancy by the entirety, how the house is owned, and we ask the court to allow these two parties to sell their home. But that's just the beginning, because you're looking at a very big life event for both my client and usually the opposing party or the opposing counsel's client, because the house is just part and parcel to this very large and sometimes lengthy process of divorce that people have gone through. And usually, unless there's a very limited circumstance, the house comes after everything is tied up in a marital settlement agreement. You're very rarely going to have the house sold at the inception of divorce. Now, why? Why is that? Because that's the largest asset of the marriage, but then there's everything else. There's bank accounts. It's hard to sell the largest asset and divvy up the proceeds before we determine the other issues in divorce. Parenting plan. You know, who's going to take care of the kids? What's the custody arrangement going to be? What type of responsibility does each parent have? Then we're dividing bank accounts. Then we're dividing other assets, business interests, and so forth. Then we're looking into alimony, child support, attorney's fees and costs, and at the end, typically, there's the marital residence. So what are the pitfalls, and how can you and I, me the divorce professional, the legal professional, and you as the real estate professional, work together? I think the most important thing that you have to understand is you have to work as a neutral. You're working with me, but you're working with me as an equal as you're working with opposing party. If there is, you know, another lawyer, you call each of them equally, if you need to call each of them equally. I think when you approach an attorney about, well, I've done divorces and I've dealt with divorces, tell them how you've managed it. Explain to them. And here's the things that Andrew and I certainly look for. One, I have experience dealing with this emotion. I understand the emotions of the parties. I've listed a divorce home before. That helps a lot. I know the area in which they're selling. Most of our files are in Palm Beach and Broward County, so that's sort of vague. But if you say, for example, I do, you know, a lot of houses on the water in Broward, okay, that's going to be very attractive to us because you're going to know what the fair market value is. You're going to be able to inform the clients of that. One client might say the fair market value is X and this is divorce. The other person might say it's Y. And you as a professional have to say, I've been doing this for a number of years and this is what I perceive based on the market conditions to be a fair market value. So you got to come with knowledge. Don't come to a divorce attorney thinking about profit because it's transparent. We know it. And it becomes very obvious at inception why you're coming to us. I want to be able to recommend someone who can turn over a home. Why? Why do we want it turned over? As I said, the agreement is done. Usually I'm bringing these people to court and we're getting a little sheet of paper that says final judgment that incorporates, okay, this agreement. And the contract could sometimes be 60 pages long. And in that contract, it discusses the sale of the house. And that is exactly what Kevin referenced. That's called a marital settlement agreement. You have to be able to read it. It's usually pretty simple so my clients can understand what's going on. And there are any number of things that you should be looking for. Lines of credit. I mean, HELOCs are huge. That is a very big problem. Clients will often say, okay, I have, you know, a line of credit I pay X amount per month on, and for some odd reason at closing, you know, it's maxed out. And you have to be very wary of being in constant communication with both sides and saying, okay, just be transparent with them. Is there a HELOC? You know, how much money is it for? How much, you know, how much is owed on the house? You know, and what are your expectations from me? And then there's working with the attorneys. We like to be people's friends. Despite any sort of myths or, you know, that you hear about divorce attorneys, brokers are our best friends because brokers help move this case towards resolution. When our clients leave that marital settlement agreement, quite frankly, we hope to never see them again. It's signed, sealed, delivered, and now it's up to you. And when our clients come back to us and say, you know, thank you for referencing Joe, but Joe has kind of blown it for us. And for any number of reasons, Joe might have blown it. And usually it's not even Joe's fault, as we find out. We give a lot of credence to what the brokers are telling us. Because my client has temporary exclusive use and occupancy of the marital residence during the pendency of the sale. So what do you think, rhetorically, if anyone wants to participate, what do you think their impetus is to sell the house?
They don't want to, and they're showing the difficulty.
Right, right. They don't want to sell the house. I'm living here, right? Maybe the other party is paying HOA, mortgage, you know, maintenance, and everything else. This is a dream, you know, this is what I always wanted. My kids are happy, they have their rooms, nothing has changed. Even though there's an agreement that says we have to sell the house with broker Joe, it's not working out. So how do you handle that situation? It's not easy, right? What you do is perhaps you call the attorney, or perhaps you speak to both parties and you say, there's an agreement. I'm just doing my job. Let's come together. This is what the fair market value is. I'm trying to help you get the maximum value for your house, you know, and let's talk about it, right? Is it going to be easy to talk to my client who doesn't want to sell, who has no real incentive to sell right away? It's rhetorical, but no, it's not going to be necessarily easy. So that's when perhaps you bring the attorneys in and the attorneys advise them, you know, there is an order of the court and it's a good idea to follow it. Okay, so we talked about a partition and we talked about how usually the sale of the house comes at the end. Okay, now, how do you meet divorce attorneys and how do you establish your niche? I think a lot of you want to know that, right? There are a lot of you. There are a lot of us, okay? But there's one constant through all our files, okay? the vast majority of them have a home at the end of them. So how are you guys networking yourselves right now, just you can tell me, towards, you know, matrimonial attorneys? Do any of you do it? Well, you should be ashamed of yourselves, because I'll tell you, I don't know about the vagaries of the real estate market. I don't know if it's going to be so hot. Kevin would probably say it is, and he's probably right, okay? But I know we have a new president. I'm not getting political. Rates are rising. I don't know if wages are rising with rates. I don't know if we're going to be selling as many homes. But the one constant is going to be divorce. So think about it. I worked on Wall Street before I went to law school. So my whole thing was, you know, I had to look at risk reward, you know, and plan ahead. You have to plan ahead. What's the probability going to be that people are just going to keep buying and buying and selling houses? What is it going to be? It's an unknown. It's an X. I don't really know real estate, you know, but I do know that divorce is going to be there. And I do know that people are going to have to sell their house. So let's talk about what's the best way to market to divorce attorneys. For me, I like to eat lunch. I mean, today we're eating lunch. I'm sure maybe some of you are here for the lunch. I mean, I don't know why you're here, but I think lunch is a good idea. Call them up. We're fairly accessible, you know. I mean, I know Andrew has a calendar, you know, with lunches. We just lunches like for months at a time. Meet with them. Hang out with them. Ask them questions. This is a good opportunity. I mean, I'm going to answer all your questions to the extent that I can, but you should be marketing yourselves towards matrimonial attorneys. And where can you find them? Just as easy as finding real estate agents. Some of them advertise, you know. If you specialize in a certain county, you know, Broward. Well, Broward's my niche, you know. Get into other counties, you know. Sometimes the real estate in Palm Beach is much more expensive. You know, we're in Broward and Palm Beach. I mean, we've had cases in Jacksonville. I don't think you should fly up to Jacksonville and meet those people, but get to know areas very well. Maybe specialize in an area. When I had to decide which type of law I wanted to practice, I said, well, this is what I love, so I'm going to do this type of area, you know. And I think that if you say, well, I'm going to do my niche in divorce, it might be a little limiting, but get to know the attorneys. It's really good. Real estate attorneys also. But divorce attorneys, most definitely. Because I know Andrew and I, we know who can turn over a house right now. And it doesn't mean it can't be one of you in 30 days flat. We know who can call, you know, Ibiza, Spain recently, okay, or some other place to get foreign money to buy a house that needs to be turned over in under 30 days. And why? Because my client is never going to stop annoying me until that house is sold. Okay? Because they're waiting for that money, you know, and you have to deliver. There's a lot of pressure on us, and there's equal pressure on you when we turn it over. But I'm sure that's true of any real estate transaction. Sellers want to sell. They want to get, it's very simple, the most for their money in the shortest amount of time. So if you're a person who can locate buyers, do it. And if you're a person who really is hungry to locate buyers and really is hungry for listings, which is why you're here today, contact divorce attorneys. Very approachable people, despite what you may think. Does anyone have any questions generally about marketing to divorce attorneys and sort of any other things that, you know, Kevin brought up or anything like that? What's your name, by the way?
Nicole.
Nicole, pleasure.
Mm-hmm. Lots of dirty stuff, and so I looked for public record. I know how to do that, and I found a HELOC, and the numbers didn't make sense to me. And she showed me like the statement of like he's not paying. This is how much you're in arrears. They didn't make sense. So I spoke to the attorney, and she was super nice. And it was a situation where I guess the the wife didn't pay her attorney off yet, so she couldn't transfer the file to a new attorney. I don't know what happened there, but it hasn't really been moved on. She just wanted to get, you know, I sent her a listing agreement. She said she sent it to the attorney. Anyway, what is your role as the attorney in digging into that HELOC and figuring it out from both parties before we list it? Like, because I don't want to start trouble. I don't want, I mean, he's clearly not, seems like he has a restraining order, but I did find this on my own, and it, the numbers don't make sense. Where is it your, can you guys help us through the courts to sort through that title, lien search, and make sure that that's all, and this is what we have, a short sale? Or is it like on me to get with you and get, you know, where does that part come in? Because I think I might have a short sale, but she doesn't know about it, and it's in his name.
Right. So, well, just to be straight with you, in a contested divorce, okay, you have to follow what's called mandatory disclosure and a financial affidavit. So it sounds as though, generally speaking, there might be a contested divorce. And mandatory disclosure is 12.285. You don't have to necessarily know that, but you have to know that if it's a simplified petition for dissolution of marriage, you're not going to find any of that. But if you're going to find, more likely than not, in a contested divorce, a list of debts, okay? And a HELOC, if they've taken money against the HELOC, right? It's a marital debt. So it should be listed, and you should be able to intelligently speak with an attorney and say, well, did they do mandatory disclosure? It's a buzzword, but the attorney will immediately say, oh, she knows, A, it's credibility. She knows what she's doing. I know you have this listing, but maybe in the future, having that knowledge will help you. And is there an FA? Use that term. Awesome. Financial affidavit. So it will list, you know, the HELOC with Bank of America or Citibank or whomever, right? And it will show how much is owed on the HELOC. Get to know those documents. You can find them online. And if any of you have ever been divorced, which is likely by statistics half of this room, you probably know what I'm talking about. So get to know what a mandatory disclosure document looks like, and get to know what a financial affidavit looks like. That way you're ahead of the attorney. Here's the thing. What you're describing is an attorney who is likely withdrawing from the case.
Yeah.
Well, right? And how much impetus does she have if she's getting out as the attorney?
No, this is the new attorney.
Oh, the new attorney.
I didn't know that there was an old attorney until when I spoke to the new attorney. The new attorney said, I just got the file. She hasn't paid her last attorney, so I haven't gotten everything released to me yet.
Right.
That's where I stand. So that, I didn't know that. That's not what the woman told me. She just said, here's my attorney's number, and I just kind of said, I just want to introduce myself, and so we're all on the same page, and that's when I found out. And she was super sweet and helpful, and she's like, once I get an idea of what's going on, I'll let you know, but it seems like she didn't even, it wasn't even close to where I thought it was based on how she was talking to me.
Good, but you're ahead. And here's the other thing. Is there someone on the other side? You're talking to someone's attorney.
Wife.
Why aren't you talking to husband's attorney? Weren't you retained by both? This is something that, this is what I talk about. You have to be neutral, right?
Yeah.
You don't represent the wife.
Yeah, that's true. She's the one who called me to give her an idea of how much she could get.
Yeah, why didn't why didn't you call the husband?
I couldn't, I guess.
If I were the husband's attorney, okay, and you called wife without calling husband, that could be an issue. It's just, these are the pitfalls that we sometimes move ourselves into. Because it just seems so obvious. The wife, she's so nice, she's so easy to work with, but there's a flip side to that divorce. There's a husband on the other side. Or, you know, in this day and age, there could be a wife on the other side, you know? So make sure you're a neutral, because you run the risk, and I've seen too many brokers fall into this, is that, yeah, this husband's awesome. You know, he's just totally, or wife is awesome. He or she is totally helping me with everything. The house is always show ready, whatever, and then suddenly they're off the listing. So my advice to you, it's not legal, it's just practical. Be in touch with both parties.
I wanted to, I was a little scared because she said there was a restraining order and was dangerous, and so I was waiting to hear from her attorney to give me everyone's information. Because it was, and I get you for sure. It just was more of like very nascent stages of the process.
Right.
And she wanted to just know how much they can get for it. And I gave her kind of like a CMA and, you know, listing agreement. And she said that I'd be in touch with the other one once she could.
Did you give the other side a listing agreement? It's, I'm not trying to,
No, I get you. That's why I'm here.
Yeah.
I mean, I didn't get in touch with the other side. Only because I went, I saw the property, and I gave her a number.
This is what I would suggest. Is if it's a Broward case, we have what's called the Sunshine Laws in Florida. We have very, very open public records. You can look up any case on the record. and you could see who the attorney is. And then you go to the Florida Bar website, find a lawyer, and their phone number is going to be listed on the Florida Bar website. And then you call the attorney. And fear, by the way, of a restraining order or something like that, comes with the territory, unfortunately. That's what we trade in. I mean, we deal with that, and whether it's, remember, a lot of this is alleged, so you don't know, you know, I'm not making any comment about this particular situation, but I mean, fear, I've seen people go crazy over a lot of things that aren't related to divorce, okay? But in the sale of a home, make sure you're involving both parties. It's very important, because I know Andrew and I, there was some listing in Wellington, and the guy was gone. And he was doing a bang-up job. It was, as Kevin said, don't waste so many hours, because you guys aren't paid necessarily by the hour, my understanding. You know, you're paid by if you can sell it. So you could be spending 20, 30, 40 hours on something. And even though the payoff materially might be really strong or whatever the fee structure is, the commission structure is, make sure you're following protocol. The best protocol is to get friendly with both attorneys and make sure that both parties feel comfortable with you.
What would you suggest is the conversation to be had when I get this guy's number? Like that Joe Schmo wife reached out to me to get some information.
I want to keep you apprised of everything that's going on. Here's where we are in the listing. You don't have to, your job is just to keep everyone informed so there are no surprises. Because as an attorney, if I find out my client's house got sold and he didn't have any say in it, you know, you'll be calling Kevin Tacher. And I don't want you to do that.
I guess my concern was that it was so early in the process, I didn't want to overstep my position. It was more of me giving them a number and then she sending it to her attorney, and then her attorney was in contact with the other guy. So I didn't know if it was me already being presumptuous to call the other attorney. I didn't get the listing. He needs to sign it. His name is on it. So that's kind of where I was at. I didn't want to be too...
Part of it, you can communicate with the other attorney. You know, two important sites. You know, when we do a search, we have software that searches public record. But you can do the same search we do by just Googling if it's Broward County Public Records and Broward County Court Records. You know, like the guy we caught stealing homes, I just go every day to Broward County Court Records. I put in his last name. I see the case. I saw that he went before the judge on Monday and he got a continuance. And the document's there. You click on it, open it, you see it's signed by the judge. So you can follow their case along and see, as he was saying, who the attorney is, reach out to them. And part of it is, like he said, it's just simple communication with them that, you know, if you search the public record and you see, let's say there were two mortgages and you don't see satisfactions. Because when you go there, you're going to see a list of documents that show up. And now you have the ammunition to be able to go to the other side and say, I'm working on getting the listing. Obviously, I'm representing your client as well as, you know, whichever other attorney's client. Here are the mortgages that I see. So I think we may be faced with a short sale situation, which now you've got a double whammy. Because not only you're dealing with a divorce, but you're dealing with potential foreclosure short sale, which is going to be very difficult because typically one party is going to say, well, I'm living in the house, I'm not paying anything, why would I want to leave, right? So it's a very difficult situation where you have to really look at time value of money and say, is it even worth it to work on it? If the house is completely upside down, if the husband is not being rational, you know, he's a criminal, let's say, you know, if they have restraining orders and he's done some things he probably shouldn't be doing, it may not even be worth it for you. If their attorney's not going to play ball, because from the sounds of it, he's not going to play ball with you. He's going to automatically...
I don't even know if they have an official, if there's any case record yet, if it's that nascent of the stage of it.
Well, if they had an attorney before, there's most likely something, someone was probably served paperwork. And at that point, there's usually attorneys. There may not, but that's where the public record would show you.
Yeah,
and there may not be. It may just be someone calling you saying, I'm thinking about getting divorced, or I spoke to a divorce attorney, but they haven't actually paid the fee, because it would cost money to open a case, serve the other party.
That's what I think is the case, is that lady said she didn't pay the attorney, then she's waiting for that.
Yeah,
so I don't want to take too much of your time. Just, like,
this is what I'm here for. Yeah. So when you look on the public record in Broward, right? It's going to say FMCE, okay? That's how they, right? And that's how you look. Or it's going to say DVCE, which could be a civil domestic violence case. So you want to see that FMCE. It just will make you feel warm inside to know that something may or may not have been filed and served. And like Kevin said, it costs money to file and serve. Even if the person is on their own and without an attorney, it costs money to file and serve. So, you know, that's something you really want to look for, because she might be and another thing is, this woman might be calling you, and she, as Kevin said earlier, she might own the house. It might be titled as tenancy by the entirety. So I talked about a partition, right? You can't break the entirety on your own. You need the other party. You need the, you know, if they're married, right? I'm married, let's say, to Andrew here, okay? I'm married to Andrew. We're both on the title. I can't just get off and sell the house. I have to ask the court to break the entirety in order so we own it in a different way, and thereafter I can sell the house. So she might be asking you to do something that you can't do anyway, because that would require either a court order or the authorization and consent from the other party to do what's called a quitclaim deed or some other sort of instrument that conveys title to one party. So, yeah, you don't want to also walk into a situation where you're trying to sell someone's house and you don't have the authority by law to even sell the house. So, but that's a great, this is a great line of questions. And I'm psyched that you asked about them, because it really is very important for people to know. It's not just about communication with attorneys. So maybe the next conversation with the attorney, who it sounds like has a retaining lien on the file, okay, to ask, you know, has anything been filed, right? Is there a divorce, right? You know, you're not an attorney, so you don't know, you know, how is it owned? How is the property owned, you know? And one thing that Kevin brought up that was really excellent, okay, turn it away. You know, if you don't want to take a listing because it smells bad, I turn cases away, ask him. I mean, you know, smell, it doesn't pass the smell test. You know, there are plenty of lawyers who will take this case, you know, plenty of them. You can find one. There are plenty of brokers who will take that on, and they might get in trouble doing it, but you know, maybe you'll save yourself a lot of aggravation and with no material return at the end. So that's something to watch out for sure. You're welcome.
Is there always going to be a marital settlement agreement in the divorce case?
Okay, that's a good question. No, because sometimes there will be what's called a final judgment after a trial that ends a divorce. And obviously, marital settlement implies that the parties settled. Some cases are taken to trial. And when they're taken to trial, you get a final judgment. And on that final judgment, that will tell you, inform you, you know, what's going on. There's also other types of orders that are worth mentioning, but you might not always see. I said that most of the time, it's at the end of the case that you're selling the house. But most is not all. Sometimes, in limited situations, you'll have someone file what's called an interim partial equitable distribution. And they'll ask for a sale of the marital residence or a piece of property owned by both parties during the pendency of the divorce. Okay? Sometimes we try for it, and very rarely granted, but look for it. So maybe it's good to know your divorce attorneys, you know, not after the file. Start getting to know your divorce attorneys now. Because if you can prove, hey, I can turn things over and I know that they're in the pendency of divorce, that's really good brokering. Because, you know, obviously if something like that is filed and then ordered by the court, it means something.
Yeah, if you can put yourself in a position where we spoke when we did the last one about the marketing, if you can put yourself in a position to where divorce attorneys are calling you to find out what a house is worth, that's golden, right? That's what you should be looking for. Because they're going to call you and say, hey, I have a client, they're thinking about getting divorced, they think this is what the house is worth, can you tell me your expert opinion? And more likely than none, you're going to be introduced to do the listing. So part of that networking, that's where you can step in and meet someone like a divorce attorney and say, I can help you. I can tell you what the house is worth when you need that opportunity. You know, I've had conversations with Todd. He's called me and said, hey, I have these clients thinking about selling. You know, what can we do from a title perspective? You know, how does it get handled? When I first met him, they say, well, we have the husband's going to get paid X and the wife is going to get, can you navigate through that? Because most title companies will tell you no. Most will tell you we're either splitting it 50-50 or we'll give it to the court to decide because we're not getting involved in an argument between the spouses. Where we will say, no, we're going to sit down and review it. And if it says there are credit cards that need to be paid, we'll pay the credit cards. Where again, most won't do it. But we've done that where we've said we'll list all of the debts that need to be paid. We'll pay them all off for them. We'll split the proceeds however the parties agree to split, usually through their attorney or there's a court order. But we will do it. We'll do it for them to make sure that, you know, we can get it done. So it's part of having your network, part of having your team. And there's no reason each one of you can meet with a divorce attorney and get them to call you, right? They'll call you because you're an expert at what you do. You have the experience to navigate through the emotional side. Because we know with foreclosures and short sales, you're not a realtor. You're a therapist, right? You're a therapist, because I know when we sit at the closing table in a short sale or a foreclosure, it's a therapy session. It's not a real estate closing. Unfortunately, that's just not what happens. Because they're coming in, they're stressed out, they want to see how much money am I getting? Oh, we're getting relocation money. How is that money going to be split? You know, these are all the conversations that come up that we see that you want to be prepared for. Because Chase used to pay $30,000 relocation. Well, who's going to get it? The house is in the husband's name, but not the wife's name, but meanwhile, they both have to sign. The husband says, well, no, that's my money. It's not really her house, but there's some reason that she's signing, right? She has to sign for a reason, and that's usually to sign over her rights to the house. So should she be split that money, or is because the loan's only in the husband's name, does the husband have the right to keep that money, right? So a lot of these things are what's gonna come up, and then at the closing table, it's gonna be a problem. And what do you wanna leave the closing table with? Your money, right? So you don't want it to have to be stopped. All of a sudden we stop the closing, the parties don't agree, now the short sale expired, now we have to start the process all over again. So getting all of the information up front for you will make it. So in your case, you know, where it could be a short sale situation, do your homework ahead of time. She has every right, I mean, hopefully to know what that line of credit is. You should be able to look and see, hey, there was a line of credit with a maximum limit of $110,000. And you should tell her, we may be faced with a line of credit at $110,000. You need to find out how much is owed being the wife. That's what the conversation you have to have. And if you find out you're in a short sale situation, it may not be worth your time. You know, it just truly may not be worth it. Because if they're not, parties aren't going to agree, you may be better off just stepping back saying, attorney, we're in a short sale situation. Here's the listing agreement. If you can get both people to agree to list the short sale, then I'll step back in and do it. And now you look like an expert because you did all your homework ahead of time. Or sometimes even a title search. To run a title search would be worth it for you.
I spoke to Mark, but yeah.
Yeah, it may be worth it. You know, for the $100, you run a search on the property and you see what liens are out there, what judgments are out there. You know, especially understand the difference between a homesteaded property and a non-homesteaded property. If it's an investment property, there may be liens or judgments, or in the case that we had, it was a bond for bail, you know, criminal bail bond that they lien the house. And the husband's like, that's not my responsibility. It was her responsibility. She should pay for that. Well, no, you both own the house. You're both selling the house. Unfortunately, you have to split it. You know, or we stop the closing, call your attorney, file a suit against her because she stole money from you. And it's not worth it at that point. He says, I'm going to spend more in legal fees than I'm ever going to recover because the money's owed regardless. So what is he going to do? Throw her in jail for stealing money? If you can even prove it. I mean, you look at the guy we caught red-handed in the office with the feds around, cameras, and the guy still hasn't been prosecuted. Nobody wanted anything to do with it. You know, that's how scary it is. So imagine parties that actually know each other. What are the chances that he's going to actually file a criminal suit against her and have her arrested for theft and then win? It's not going to happen. So he says, you know what, I'll take my money and have a nice day.
Here's another thing. Yeah, Kevin talked about running a title search. I mean, to me, I don't know your business. To me, that would be a reflex. I mean, before I even take on, right, a listing, I'm running a title search. I mean, I'm not a broker. I don't pretend to know. But, I mean, you're taking on an awesome responsibility. You have the pressure of a divorced couple. You have two lawyers, sometimes more, sometimes an entire law firm, right, that you're working with. I'm not saying this to scare you. I'm saying this because if you can master this expertise, okay, you will distinguish yourself from all the other brokers. And, you know, having every tool at your disposal to not only impress the lawyers, which is part of it, but also to impress the people whose house you're selling, you know, because they're parting way with something that they really thought when they bought it, it would be theirs. And homestead, that's very important. You know, the Save Your Homes Act was passed in Florida, and it's a very unique law. It's the O.J. case, you know. I mean, O.J.'s playing golf in Florida after the O.J. Simpson trial on a homesteaded house. My information, it was a homesteaded house in Florida. You know, he got a civil suit after the verdict, okay, for umpteen million dollars, but he's playing golf, right? Homestead is very unique to Florida. You should definitely find out, just have the knowledge. Go in there. I call Kevin because he knows more about real estate than I do. I mean, and it's a sign of intelligence in my mind to call the people who know more than you do. I mean, he's the resource. He talked about, I've had files that they're very complex real estate transactions, okay? And yeah, I call other lawyers, but sometimes it's not about lawyers. It's nuts and bolts, and that's what I rely on the brokers for. One other thing is that once you establish your niche within the market, they know that if I give you a listing, you know, I can set it and forget it. I'm done. You know, the lawyers are exhausted at the end of this. I mean, literally and figuratively. They don't want to be involved in the listing. It's not their goal. Their goal is, here's your listing, you know, here's your opportunity. Now do everything that has to be done. And I don't necessarily do this, but a lot of attorneys will be like, well, you're getting money for this, right? And this is the attitude. Do what has to be done. Don't call me, don't bother me. Figure it out, you know, and get the thing sold. I mean, unfortunately, sometimes the lawyers, not all, take on the emotions of the client that say, I want the house sold. I don't care how you do it, you know, do it, you know. So there are certain things that I can just tell you based on my experience that I've seen brokers do that prevents the sale, okay? One, you're not a lawyer, and that's very important. Especially in a contested divorce, they tend not to love the adversarial system at the end. You are a voice of calm and reason. I think that's the best approach. You know, I'm calm, I'm reasonable, I'm not super aggressive, because sometimes that's the lawyer's job, to zealously advocate on behalf of their clients. But by the end, they're kind of tired of it. You know, all that tone and so forth. They want someone who's like, yeah, I'm gonna help you out. I have a lot of knowledge. I'm gonna make you feel good about this, even though it's been a rough go for you. And I'll develop a rapport with both of you without being intimate with either of you. And when I mean intimate, you know, if you start talking in front of the husband about, and you ask, you know, how was the wife's, you know, concert that she went to, you know, 3 nights ago. Bye. I mean, you can have that relationship, have it equally. And you kind of want to leave the lawyers out of it to the extent that you can. They can be informed, but really, you have a job. We're putting an enormous responsibility in your hands, you know, just as when I take on someone's divorce, right? And the future of their children and where they're going to go and who's going to take care of the children and how much child support and how much income and how much alimony and all that is sort of among our many responsibilities. You know, as a real estate professional, and I love how he uses the word professional because you are professionals, it's your responsibility to navigate these people through to the end, you know, to take it to the end. So I think that's very important. I mean, the lawyers are trusting you, but more importantly, so are the clients who you're representing. You know, this is their future. You know, this is, to get the good price will mean a great deal to them, because, you know, without going into the details, divorce is a split. You know, you're splitting lives. They might want to stay in the same school district. It might not be tenable. You know, they want to buy another house, you know, so they're depending on you selling this house so they can buy another one. And I'd like, maybe Kevin can go about, okay, what happens on the refinancing and the aftermath and the recidivist business that you can get from a, we don't get recidivist business necessarily. We don't want to, we sometimes do. But the recidivist business you can get, you sell one home for people, what are they doing afterwards sometimes?
Yeah, I mean, one deal can turn into three for you, right? Because one party, you know, if you play both sides equally, if they're selling a house and they're each walking away with, let's say, $100,000, what are they going to do with that money? Typically, they're going to go probably buy something, maybe smaller. What we see a lot is they go from their house, their five-bedroom house, to maybe a three-bedroom townhouse. So now you just turn one client into three, right? So you're going to see that. And a lot of times he brought up a good point is refinancing. You know, one party may be refinancing to pull cash out, and then what are they doing with that cash? They're going to give it to the other spouse, and the spouse is now going to go find something. Worst case scenario, they're going to have to live somewhere. So what did we talk about at the last event, which is a good market? Any of you that were here remember? Talked about rentals. So if they're not buying, they're going to go rent somewhere. Great. So will you work with them for the rental? You may not. Maybe there's another agent that will. But if it were me, I would work with them on that rental, because what's going to happen in a year from now? That rental is now going to turn into hopefully a purchase. So you're filling the pipeline. You know, all of our classes that we're putting together will connect the dots. So part of this is talking about networking with divorce, right? Reality is if you're getting a listing in Broward County, we're not doing a closing, because the buyer is usually picking the title company, right? So usually we're not dealing with it. You can get creative and make the sellers pay for it and say, listen, I think you guys should have control of the deal, pay for title insurance like they do in Palm Beach County, so this way you have someone that can help navigate through this process. Great, that's an advanced conversation. So what we're looking for, though, are going to then be those people that are going to turn around and buy something. Hopefully then they'll choose us for closing. So, you know, you want to make sure you're setting yourself up. Meet with the divorce attorneys, get the listings. One of the other things, do you guys watch our newsletter that we do, our weekly video? We do a weekly video, Title Tuesdays, on our YouTube channel. It's on our website as well. But I think it was 2 weeks ago or last week we did the appraisal person. There's another good tool for you to leverage, right? When you have a husband and a wife and they're looking to get divorced, say, why don't we do this? Why don't we order a title search on the property? Why don't we order an appraisal on the property? So this way we can have an independent third party. And that appraisal is typically going to be a lot cheaper because it's not being used for a loan. It's not being used. All it is just an opinion of value. So it can be a limited appraisal. You know, yes, you can search the public record. You can search the MLS and tell them what the house is worth. But as Todd said, usually the realtor is weighing one side versus the other. They came to the sale by one party. Usually it was the wife or the husband brought this person in. So there's automatically thinking there's going to be favorites, right? Oh, you knew my, like he said, oh, you knew the concert my wife went to. Are you really siding with them, or are you protecting both of us? So you'll set that stage, but using a third party appraisal is not a bad option. Go back and look at that video. It's her name is Claudia, and she can do a limited appraisal. And I think Cindy has agents that are here as well that are appraisers that can do a limited appraisal for you. So now you can present with your listing agreement to them, hey, here's the appraisal, and let them bill the clients directly. They'll pay for it. And this way you have an honest opinion. This is what your house is really worth, not what you think it's worth. Because they're never going to agree. One's going to say it's worth X, one's going to say it's worth Y, and you're going to have to get them somehow to meet in the middle. So that appraisal would be good leverage for you.
Here's a problem that we sometimes run into, okay? If there's a failure on the part of the brokers, and it's not necessarily a failure, don't take yourselves as responsible for their failure. The court will then appoint a special magistrate. And that, to me, is what we call a failure. Because we've gone through brokers, and now the court has decided we're appointing a special magistrate. And we really try and not want to get to that point. So one thing you can do is, again, and as far as you picked, Kevin mentioned, you picked, you know, the wife picked the broker or whatever. What usually happens in divorce is we both sides present three names and we come to an agreement. So that's why I say you want to be on the three names for every divorce attorney, because what might happen is if you network with every divorce attorney, you'll be, your three names, suddenly you'll be like, oh, I know him or her. Yeah, so that's fine. It's a known entity. You know, wife's counsel put three names, husband's counsel put three names, and oh my, you've networked with both of these attorneys, both of these divorce attorneys. You're one of both sides' three names. It's over after that. We're not really discussing it. So that's why I say get to know everybody, because they'll at least just say, I met that broker somewhere, you know, and I'll be like, yeah, stand up. He or she knows exactly what she's doing, you know, and the other side, and then I can advocate for the broker, and the other, or not, because the other attorney will have met that broker, and it's just boom. And that's how you get to be in that niche market. You want to be on both sides' three names, or if you're not on the three names, you know, we'll be like, well, what about X? And then the attorney's like, oh yeah, I had lunch with her. I had lunch with her also. Fine, done. You know, that's how you build your reputation in this market. And the reason I say this market is because it's not going away. I don't know what's going to happen to the real estate market. For all your sakes, I hope everyone keeps buying and selling, because it seems to be pretty hot from what I can tell, but I don't know. There was a question.
I wasn't quite sure. So the process with divorce, let's say they did have all these things that needed to be sold off and split off. When you hand the realtor the listing, essentially, are they divorced? Can they be divorced at that point? Or is it all pending on everything closing out and then their divorce is final? Yeah. I'm not familiar with
that. No, that's a great question. So usually, well, there is no usually, but customarily, they are divorced. And there are usually time periods. You're going to have, I think your listing contracts typically, and I could be wrong, you'll correct me, say 6 months, right? Typically. Okay. They might have 6 months with automatic step downs in pricing. Okay. You might be brought in just as an independent broker to say, this is what I think it's worth, and then another broker says, this is what I think it's worth. And, you know, that would be your role. You know, but they're usually going to be step down periods. So the couple will say, you know what, we can't agree to the first price. We've heard the independent brokers give their opinion. So a house that will sell for six, they'll start at eight. And the agreement that you're looking at is 3 weeks later, it has to drop down to seven. And then 4 months later, it has to drop down to 650. So you're kind of sometimes guided by what they have agreed to. And that's why I say you may or may not want to undertake something like that.
But are they divorced? Are they officially divorced at that point? Can they be officially?
Oh, absolutely.
And then the decree follows, and this is what you need to do. You need to sell the house. But as of now, you are divorced, and then all these other things are happening afterwards.
Correct.
Sorry, that's like a stupid question.
There are no stupid questions. That's a good question. Yeah.
But you'll see them either way. We have people come to the closing table that are divorced and they sign the deed as single people.
Right.
And then subject to the marital settlement agreement. And we have people that come to the closing table that are still husband and wife and they're selling it, and then that money just gets split according to what they've agreed to, but there's no actual settlement agreement.
Okay.
So then it would just be split as if they were still married, which they are. It would just be split equally. So they may say give the wife X amount and the husband X amount, and that's part of where, you know, we'll come into play, because we're willing to do that. If the husband and wife agree and they say, okay, it's going to be a 60-40 split or a 70-30 split, whatever the case may be, we've seen that. We just put it on the closing statement that way, so there's never a question. And we disperse accordingly, and then the divorce may come later. So we've seen it either way. We've actually even seen it where the divorce took place ahead of time, and upon refinance of the house, the spouse will deed themselves off for a payment. So they may say, okay, so you as the husband, you're keeping the house. The kids are going to live with you. You keep the house. And if at any time you sell or refinance, this is what's going to happen. And now we have to step in and follow that. And we see that a lot as well, where they say, we just can't afford to sell it right now. You can stay there with the kids. And when you sell or if you refinance, then we split whatever the proceeds are. So if they're doing a cash out refinance, $50,000, they may get $25,000. And then they'd sign their name off the house at that point. So, you know, it's whatever is, you know, it's like anything, contract,
right.
It's negotiable. So it's whatever you negotiate and whatever time frame, because if you get a sale quick, the divorce may not be final. If it drags out a year, if it's a short sale or something and it gets dragged out, then, you know, you may be in a position where they're already divorced.
There is no chicken and egg. That's what he's saying, basically.
Yeah, it's, you have each to be one's able, different.
Yeah, you have to be malleable, because we have to be malleable. Our clients, they change their minds about stuff all the time. So you have to kind of move with the tides. And there's a lot of tide.
And the one you think is easy is going to be difficult. That free and clear house is going to be the biggest pain you've ever seen.
Yeah.
You know, I've seen it. You know, we've taken the $3-4 million sale, that's a cash sale, and it's one of the most difficult deals we've ever done. It's easier to take the smaller ones because there's less to argue about. When you have the bigger ones, there's more to argue about. Oh, they took out a lien, there's a construction on the house, they put in a new pool. Well, that's not my responsibility. They were living there at that time. Why should I have to be responsible for the pool that my wife put in the house when she kicked me out of the house? Okay, is this a therapy session or is this a real estate closing? And these are the things that you're now able to navigate and say, you know what, I have enough ammunition, I can walk in and be an expert. I know how to deal with your problems, I know how to deal with your problems, and let's come together to an agreement. And don't make the mistake of playing one side versus the other, because they'll never select you, right? So in your case, the one you were talking about would be a good idea to find the attorney for the husband if you can, and then start communicating with them to bring both parties together. Because you'll never win if you're playing the wife's side. That's what they're gonna say.
Yeah, full amortization means possibly more profit for you, but the more money you make, the more difficult it is to make it. So he's completely correct. That might smell great, you know, but it doesn't necessarily mean it's going to be easy. But the more you do, the more divorces you've done, you're ready to do those, and they, you know, obviously, they yield the most. I would expect.
It's funny because it came from like a lead source where like people indicate their reason for selling. And usually whenever I call back those leads, they've been called by like a million and one realtors, and she hasn't had that contact. So I'm wondering, like other agents, like I just avoid divorce, but I thought that was really funny because I've never called back a lead from that source that didn't get contacted from anyone.
It's one of the most difficult types of deals. You know, like same thing with the short sale. Very, very difficult to deal with it. You know, because it drags out for so long and there's so many changing factors with it, and how much are the legal fees and how much is the house really worth, and then the bank comes back and renegotiates, they want a different price, that buyer says no, so they go away, now you have to find another buyer, resubmit it. It's a pain, right? It's a real pain. Now add divorce on top of a short sale, you got a problem. And then on top of that, add a restraining order from a husband that who knows what he did. By the way, that same public record site, you can find out what he did. Because that's all public record as well. If you put his name in the clerk of courts, you could put his last name and you'll see the case, what he did, the restraining order, and everything's listed. So you know what you're dealing with, right? Did he hit her? Did he do something
there
crazy? Well,
there's
then so her story may not even
exactly.
be true.
Yeah, no, it was more of me limited touching it, and then if the attorney calls me back, I didn't want to get too into it, I was just curious.
Yeah, we've had clients,
in no way.
We've had clients bring us deals to try and sell as if they owned it themselves, and we figured out that they had a spouse and they were trying to sell a house without their spouse even knowing.
No, she wasn't. She said, I'm gonna send it to my attorney, which she did. And she said, my attorney's talking to his attorney and he's gonna agree to sell it or not. And the attorney said he agreed, he wants to sell it. And, you know, all so right, I did speak, so it wasn't like that. I was just curious.
Yeah, listen, worst case, get the listing agreement. It doesn't cost anything. Get them locked in, get the listing agreement signed, and then worry. If it's a short sale, we'll deal with it, right? We'll get it negotiated. The reality is that second mortgage will typically go away for about $1,000. That's usually what we'll see them settle in a short sale situation, because they'd rather get $1,000 than know nothing. Because if it goes to foreclosure and there's really not that much equity, they're gonna get zero. So most second mortgages will take $1,000 or $2,000 to just go away.
Just to touch on what you said, I mean, you've gotta have some freedom of fear, you know? If everyone, you know, was fearful, and that's why there are a select few who can do divorce law, you know, I think that there are a lot of brokers. Freedom from fear means attacking this market, because there aren't that many who take this on. I mean, and take it on well. So you could really develop a niche. I mean, I would not be fearful of it. I would try it. Try one. Maybe start slow, you know, not a major listing, you know, and see if you can handle the emotions. And if you're not cut for it, you know, you find out, you know.
And mediators are another good networking for you, because the attorneys are great, but a lot of times the mediators are the ones that are going to bring the three names together if it's gotten past the, you know, the reality is I've, in 15 years of doing this, I don't think I've ever seen a final judgment brought before us to sell a property. I don't know that I've ever seen one. It's usually a marital settlement agreement, because the reality is they need to settle, because otherwise it's going to be very expensive. Unless it's a high profile case, nobody has the money to take this to trial, unless it's a big, big, big case. So, you know, you're usually going to see that. They're going to go before a mediator. And wouldn't it be nice if the attorney knows you, the mediator knows you, and guess who gets selected for the closing? Just like mediators get selected. Todd knows one mediator. The other attorney says, oh, yeah, I've used that mediator. They're fair. It's going to be the same way for you. I've used that realtor. They're fair. They'll get your house sold. And now you get selected. So mediators are a good source for you to network with as well.
That's a great point he just made, because I thought about how many mediated settlement agreements we've done, and the mediator has a lot of influence. I would go to, whether you're in Palm Beach, Broward, look for any person who specializes in divorce mediation, be it retired judges or more experienced attorneys. Great source, because if parties are sitting there and they're working out the finalities, they're in caucus, which means they're in separate rooms, and they're working out the finalities of their agreement, at a certain point, you know, it comes up, well, who's going to sell the thing, right? The mediator, it's the mediator's job to potentially settle the case. So mediators are so important. I mean, that might be even more important, to go to lunch with the mediators, find out through the divorce attorneys who they use for mediation, because there are such, I mean, there's probably 12 mediators that are so ubiquitous that, like, it's like a professional athlete, like within the divorce community. You know who they are, you know, and you know that they have a lot of influence and they have their go-tos. And if you can become that mediator's go-to, more power to you, because they trust certain brokers. We've gone to the same mediator, Andrew and I, a couple of times, and all three times it was the same broker, okay? Because the lawyer knew the mediator, we knew the mediator on the other side, we came to the mediator, this broker had a really solid record, great background, you know, he's like, you know, show me a divorce, I've done hundreds of them, and this mediator said, you're using him, kind of thing, you know, and I think that that's a very important resource for all of you. Find the mediators. The only way to get to know the mediators is maybe to get an introduction from a divorce attorney, or just directly reach out to them. Make yourself accessible and available. Find out about them. Whatever you have to do. Good.
Yeah, it's about networking with them. Get on that preferred list. You know, same thing with title companies, lenders. You know, we rely on the agent. The reality is the buyer or seller they're not picking us, usually. It's the realtor that says, oh, here, write the check. Who do I make the check payable to? Oh, Independence Title. And then we just automatically start doing the closing. I just had a firefighter yesterday I was working with. His title company was charging him $1,250 closing fee, where our max fee is $770. And they were charging him $1,250. And I went with him. He says, I don't even know how they selected this person. He went to the realtor. It happened to be the realtor selected the title company for him. And he went to them and said, it's just not acceptable. You're overcharging me. It's robbery. So then they reduced it for him, you know? So that one little thing, we couldn't get the deal, but it's a perfect example. He says, oh, she's probably getting a kickback or something. That's why they overcharge me. And this is their perception. So you need to be the one that they're referring to. You need to be the one the divorce attorney has you on their preferred list. Maybe come up with a nice flyer that talks about divorce and why you're the expert, right? You can design a nice custom flyer. Any of you use Fiverr, the website Fiverr? If you write it down, fiverr.com, everything's for $5. So for $5, you can have a custom design flyer done. Not bad, right? And now you can start sending that flyer to people and say, I specialize in divorce. These are the reasons why. Just pull bullet points from the, you know, the flyer and the, you know, the invitation for this event. And these are the reasons why, because I know how to navigate the parties. I know how to play an unbiased, you know, independent third party. You know, we'll be able to get an appraisal. You know, we work with appraisers to get them in. We'll be able to pull a title search on the property and let your clients know what they're dealing with ahead of time. And imagine that, you're gonna put that flyer in front of an attorney or a mediator, they're gonna be like, I've never seen anything like this in my life. You're hired. This is the person you need to call. Because for $5, you had a nice flyer designed.
You know,
be creative.
I had a lunch with a realtor, and she told me, you know, how she stages homes when there are kids in the home. You know, how does she, you know, talk to the children? Because inevitably, the kids are being uprooted sometimes. You know, there's a real human element to what we do, you know. So how does she deal with that? She gave me a detailed explanation about how she stages a home with a child in the home, how she promises the kid, you know, when this is over, you know, if you let me have your room, you know, just for a little bit, when this is over, we'll have a catch, a softball catch or something. I don't know what it was, but she had a way of reaching out to children. So if you're good with children, you know, because you're going into their home, their lives are being changed. Okay, they're moving, you know. They really love that room, and they're going to move to another room. Okay, for better or worse, this happens now a lot. So the societal stigma is largely, it's just become part of the main. But it's how you connect to the people who you're working with. It's very important. And I thought that was brilliant, what this realtor does. Because you know you've got to be neutral with the parents, and then you're not curry favoring with the kids, you're just making them feel comfortable with you. And, you know, that's everything. And then, here's the thing, someone gets divorced, they're gonna say, for better or worse, I had the best realtor ever. You know, I mean, it's like, it's the gremlin effect, we call it, you know? If you ever saw the movie Gremlins. I mean, you drop those things in water, gizmo into the water, and you'll see, okay, all these gremlins come out. Now, you're not the gremlins, okay? But you're all good, and the effect is really strong, because they might have went through a nasty divorce, but the realtor at the end, the realtor was really nice, right? The realtor, you know, said my kid was going to have a softball catch with her, and they'll think of you.
Even the topic we put there, you say overcome obstacles with divorce in real estate, have it for the kid's best interest. And you have a whole thing designed just for the benefits of the kids. And now you can go to who else besides a mediator and a divorce attorney? Where do they go first before they even think about going to getting a divorce? Therapist? A child therapist? So network with child therapists and say, listen, when it gets to a point, because it's not if, it's when, when it gets to that point, I can now step in, and here's my flyer on how I can deal with the divorce and navigate the sale of the home with the kid's best interest.
Yeah.
And they're going to now suggest to the spouse when it gets time that they're getting divorced, and if you're thinking about selling, here's a card of a realtor that is going to work with your children to make sure they're not as damaged through this process. Right? It's all about marketing. It's a marketing twist on what you can do with the knowledge that you have. That's a great idea, you know, to make it about the kids. Make it about the kids, because that's what's gonna happen as a realtor when you go to this house and it's a listing, you need to do a showing. The person's not gonna wanna show it, or the kid, the house is a mess. So you need to have those conversations with clients. Say, how about the house looks a certain way? My daughter's mother, because I'm divorced, my daughter's mother just sold, she was forced to sell her house, I think 2-3 months ago. And I had a buyer for the house, but I couldn't talk to her because we're not amicable. And I called the realtor directly and I said, listen, I told him who I was. He said, this is the most difficult listing I've ever had. His words, I can show you in writing, his words to me was, your ex needs 24 hours to make the house look like shit. His words to me, he didn't know me from a hole in the wall. Because I honestly had a buyer, I had a lovely couple that was looking to buy the house, I knew she was selling it, and I says, I'll hand them to you, you just please deal with it, and don't ever mention my name. And then that's exactly what happened. We couldn't get them in for about a week and a half. And then they said they needed the mother to come escort, so the grandmother, my daughter's grandmother, had to come and actually do the showings from now on, because she would make the house look like such crap and put up such a wall, the mother now had to be there for all showings. Imagine that it gets to that point. So just be proactive with it. These are some of the issues we see. And now you won yourself the listing. You have to be unique. That's, you know, we spoke about it last month when we had that marketing class. You know, you have to be unique at what you do. Not just have the tools and not know how to draft the contract, but be unique and be a little different than someone else. And then you're gonna be the one that they select, guaranteed.
And just to talk about, you know, recidivist business, Kevin is now remarried. So this is obviously multiple years ago. So my point is that...
Wait, this was 12 years ago.
12 years ago. So, you know, there's still a market 12 years ago.
Yeah, this was in my house. It's not like I was selling. Right. I didn't own this house. This was a house her parents bought her 3 years ago that they had to sell because she hasn't worked in years. But the reality is this is what happens. I'm sure if you've taken a listing in a divorce, you've heard that. The spouse is being so difficult to show it. Now you have to talk to the husband or the wife and try and get everyone to agree to show this house. So be proactive. Get some tips from a therapist. Get the therapist involved, you know. There's going to be two therapists, or sometimes one therapist. There's going to be two attorneys. There's going to be a mediator. These are all the parties that need to come together in order to make sure the sale goes through. Sounds tough. It's going to be very difficult.
Well,
but
worth
it. Be profitable when you're the one that's just getting that call. That's how we're trying to teach you how to fill the funnel, right? You get that call, and then if you work through one, all of a sudden it turned into two more sales because they're each going to buy something. And that's how it works.
Plus, you're not alone. You know, you get the call, but hopefully you have a team of professionals. Like, if you get a divorce listing, right? I mean, yeah, you're alone insofar as it's your listing, but you call someone like Kevin, you know, and you say, I got a divorce listing, right? You're not going to call necessarily a divorce attorney or the other attorneys to give you comfort, you know, but you can call other real estate professionals who you confide in, mentors, whatever, and they could say, well, I've done like 20 of these, just calm down, and, you know, this is what I do. And then you ask three other people what their approach is. So you sort of figure out, you know, what, and then you create your own approach, you know. But it's moving and it has to be changing for each situation. But it's completely worth it because at the end of the day, sometimes these are major listings, you know, and they're ready. Sometimes the sellers are hungry to sell. So it's really, you know, in a perfect world, it's just about finding a buyer. That's the perfect scenario. It's just like, okay, I just have to find a buyer. I need a match for this. Questions? Well, okay, that's a good question. You got a listing through whom? The attorney?
No.
Okay, so you get a listing, the people are undergoing a divorce?
No, years ago. And the property was actually inherited. Like in the final months of the divorce.
You have to look at the title. Who's on the deed? I mean,
it's still on title, which means probate was probably never done.
No. Well, actually, no. That's with the HOA public record. It's just the daughter on the title.
The daughter, meaning the divorce.
The divorced
woman.
Yeah.
That's. I mean, I would have to know a lot.
Yeah,
more.
You'd have to see the agreement. A lot of times
I'd
in the agreement.
And that's what I'm getting to. How
some of them say that, maybe to hide the fact that it's in there that, you know, one party gets it or not. Usually all assets are disclosed, but if it happened after the fact, then there may not be one.
Okay, so what I would do is you check what county you think they were divorced in and see if the case was disposed. So you go to the public record, you look at that. If it's a divorce in Broward, if it's not in Broward, you just go FMCE, public record. You look at the docket. If it was disposed, you know it was disposed. And then you see how it was disposed. Dockets, you just read the docket. It's one way to do it. But you're describing a very complex situation.
When one person is owns a property, and at the time they own the property is single, then they get married. Mm-hmm. The property is a homestead. What happened? The person that gets married to that person is entitled to part of the property at the divorce, or what?
Well, that is a very loaded question, a very difficult question to answer. A lot of it depends on title. How is title been transferred? You know what I mean?
Yeah, if it's still in the one spouse's name, we will call, if it's a homestead, we have to call for joinder of the other spouse. And what is that spouse going to typically want? Money, right? If it's their homestead in the state of Florida, the day you say I do, it now becomes a marital asset, especially if there's money being paid to keep up the house. So that spouse is going to say, well, I've helped raise the children in this house. I've helped pay the bills in this house. So it's tough. It's a tough conversation. That's where we see a lot of people come to us and try and sell it without their spouse, and they don't say they're married. They'll come in and say they're single, and they try and sell it, and they get the money. And then a spouse, that's where title insurance kicks in, because then they would have a potential claim. That spouse can now come in and say, I own half this house. I've lived here for 15 years. He bought it when he was single, but I've lived here, and I've helped pay the bills, and I've helped maintain this house. And they have a valid claim.
I'm going to render no legal opinion on that. Just not. It's very difficult to answer just based on what you're telling me. There's a lot of research that has to be done on something like that.
What is like a typical case where they have to go? You know, a typical question we got is the question I tell you.
Yeah, that's a big disputed issue actually. Like there's a lot of. That sometimes is a very heavily litigated issue. So to say that there's typical, there is no typical. Kevin mentioned things that are, you know, facts that we look into, for sure. You know, without getting too technical, just the idea that, you know, was there appreciation of the house? You know, how is it titled? Was there ever a transfer title? Things like that, you know. But, you know, it's a very... That's a very sensitive issue, and as a realtor, I wouldn't necessarily render an opinion on that. Because you don't want to be construed as trying to play lawyer, just as I would never try and play realtor. I look at Zillow. That's kind of amateurish, right?
Does it change when it's not a homestead?
Yeah. If it's not homestead, it could be an investment property. If it's an investment property, it may not be subject. In other words, if, as an example, my wife, her parents passed away, and she received a settlement from the estate, she can now go purchase a rental property, and I have no rights to that rental property. It was from her inheritance. So she could technically turn around and sell that property, and the money would just flow straight to her. It's when you have a homesteaded property that question is really going to have to be analyzed by the attorneys. Because I can almost guarantee the opposite side is going to have an argument that spouse has rights to that property. Because it was their homestead, that's where they raised their family, that's where they lived. You know, she paid part of the bills in that house. And that's the conversation they're going to have, because it wasn't an investment purchased with non-marital assets. Right? Does that make sense somewhat? Without giving legal advice?
He is absolutely getting into very convoluted questions that have to be asked. I mean, there's so many questions that have to be asked in that scenario that as a broker, if I were a broker or a professional, I would probably get a lawyer on it, and not necessarily a divorce lawyer. It might be a real estate lawyer. You know, if you have access to a real estate lawyer who you're friends with, you know, all of you should have 2 to 10 to 20 to 100 real estate lawyers in your pockets, I'm sure, because you're going to get a lot of listings that way as well. That's also a good resource. But as far as the non-marital property and its conversion into marital assets and so forth, it's not so streamlined. That's why we have to do our jobs, and that's why it's not so formulaic. It's very difficult. And that's part of the chore, or what I call the blessing of discovery in a case. So it's just not so obvious.
And that's one of the biggest title claims that we see are either mortgages that weren't paid off, or someone that had an interest in the property that came back after the fact and said, I'm owed money from this sale. And they weren't paid off for whatever reason. It could be a spouse, it could be an heir to an estate. So that's the importance when people ask for title insurance. There's the reason why, because heirs and people will come back after the fact putting a claim to that property. And now title insurance has to step in and pay them out. So it's definitely left up to the attorneys. You know, I mean, I'm telling you what I see from a closing perspective, where we close houses every day that it's titled as a married person, you know, married man, married woman, and those houses typically close and the proceeds go to the one spouse. Because if it's non-homestead, they never live there, they don't file tax returns there, it's a rental property, they have the right to sell that asset without joinder from a title perspective of the other spouse. Homesteaded property is different. If it's your homestead, legally you have to have joinder of the spouse. That's why if you ever were to see a title commitment, it says so-and-so, a married man, if homestead, needs joinder of the spouse. That's where our title commitments come in, because it's our job to analyze, do they have a homestead exemption on the property? Do they live in the property? They may not have a homestead on the property, but they live in the property. Their tax return has the address of that property. So just as we use homestead to dismiss judgments, we would have to then take it the other way and use homestead to give rights to a spouse.
Homestead is used and it's abused. You know, I mean, it's a real benefit of this state, but you know, Kevin's describing various situations in which it can be used. You know, it can be really beneficial in terms of non-ad valorem taxes and sort of keeping, you know, your property taxes where they are, and also, you know, creditor protection and so forth. But we see abuse of it all the time in our practice. You know, so just, I think what I hope you get out of this discussion, because you hit a nerve, which is awesome. That's what you should be doing, is that beware. When it smells a little funny, beware. Have your attorneys there, you know, talk to them, tell them the story, you know, do your own due diligence to an extent, talk to title companies, you know, because it's so easy just to take the listing. And I think hopefully thematically, that's what this lecture is all about. It's so easy to take a listing. It's so easy for us to take a case. It's gotta be correct. It's gotta pass smell tests. Client can't be hiding, you know, they've gotta ask, they've gotta be candid with us. You know, they've gotta feel comfortable with us. You know, and if I feel like this is not going to work out, bye. If you feel like it's not going to work out, have the courage to know that the next listing is around the corner. Now, if you think that you can solve the problem and you can give them an honest assessment of what you can do and what you can't do, do your due diligence, but don't reflexively accept something, because it might not pass the smell test, and then you're going to be in real trouble on the back end, and you'll make no money, which is not a good thing. So good question. Thank you. Awesome. Thank you guys so much.